Iori joined again by Draskel. Draskel, thank the Lord, we have a first ban on Monkey King, so hopefully the client will hold steady coming into this game. So now that that's out of the way, how are we feeling here? Game two.
I think that game one was pretty misleading if you look at like kind of how it turned out, in that Ramsey's 10-second BKB timing just hit perfectly, and they got an amazing team fight off the back of it that kind of just completely crippled Faceless for the rest of the game. It's kind of like, you know, you have this really evenly matched fight, and then someone just randomly gets their arm chopped off, and it's like, oh, well, that's going to be a really hard game after that point. So I think their draft still was capable of winning, but after that first really bad fight with a 10-second BKB of Ramsey's, it was just insurmountable, almost, the lead that Virtus Pro managed to accrue. So for the first time today, we're going to get to see a tree. I think he's been banned in all three of the other games.
Yeah.
So I'm looking forward to it and want to see how impactful it can be.
Yeah, it's a cool hero. It reminds me a little bit, not a complete one-to-one, but of the old Undying, you know, maybe a few years ago, where he was seldom picked, but when he was picked up, teams would just avoid him in the laning stage because he's so strong in those early levels. And Treant has that similar vibe. You just can't trade blows with him. You know, when he picks up Orb of Venom, you don't really have a choice but to play defensive and try to run away. And there's that window in the mid-game where Tree can feel a little underwhelming. Darkseer, one of the better heroes to deal with Treant just in general. You know, Ion Shell against the Living Armor, so there are some options to deal with him. I don't know. I'm not totally convinced that Treant is first pick, first ban worthy. I feel like it's still because he's just new, and you know, teams feel like he has that surprise factor. But maybe that's just me. I mean, what do you think about the tree, Draskel? Are you sold? Are you on the tree hype train?
I think he's super strong for sure. He kind of fulfills the same role as like your Spirit Breakers, your, you know, Ogre Magi's, what have you. Mm-hmm. He provides global lane support, which not really many other heroes do that aren't like in the mid capacity, like Sunstrike from Invoker, you know, comes to mind. But I still think the hero is extremely good, but like you said, not entirely convinced. But again, I haven't really seen it in competitive plays, so yeah. I guess now will be like the first real time we can gauge the true strength of the hero. And obviously Faceless feel like it's good enough to pick up, so Witch Doctor going to be following that. Really nice counter pick into the Slardar and the Darkseer, two heroes that typically want to be on the front line together. You Ion Shell the Slardar, he blinks in. You Ion Shell yourself, you blink in. You know, combo plays happen.
Yeah.
But the paralyzing cast can be a huge deterrent to stuff like that.
Yeah, I like the Witch Doctor pick. We talked about him in the last game, I think. But quite good here. Really good at killing Darkseer and Slardar in those early levels with the Maledict, and like you were talking about, the coconut, always a threat. Looking at bans, Medusa actually banned out. You mentioned her to pair the Magnus earlier today, at least, but actually something Virtus Pro will take out alongside the Jug, and a third ban here on the Lifestealer from Faceless.
Yeah, the Lifestealer ban makes complete sense. I already have a Slardar. You know, Darkseer is one of those, call it an enabler hero, right? Mm-hmm. It makes other heroes that normally are pretty lackluster into something that can be terrifying. Lifestealer is already good on his own, but when you get Surge and Ion Shell on top of that, he becomes an absolute terror. So Troll, going to be the next ban out. Obviously, Ramsey's just had a brilliant performance on Troll. I think only died like a handful of times, and most of those deaths were pretty much being inside of Faceless base.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to fault him too much for that one. But that does mean that it opens up the Warlock for VP, which, you know, interestingly enough, Nuts, he pretty much plays Warlock, Witch Doctor, and Crystal Maiden. Those are like his big three, if you will. And I think he's like actually one of the best Warlock players after having watched, you know, a couple of Faceless games in the past. But, you know, Virtus Pro, they got that really big team fight. Fatal Bonds, really, really good when you have things like Darkseer, and like one wombo combo can just be like the end of a team fight right then and there.
Yeah.
And plus, you know, Chaotic Offering, super easy to land when you have Darkseer, because you get like that guaranteed kind of mini stun, and then the Sardar can, you know, potentially even go in later than that.
Yeah, a lot of team fight potential for Virtus Pro here. For Faceless, a lot of options with this draft. You know, opening two supports. They could do something like a position one Venge with Treant Witch Doctor. There are certainly some options there. Two supports that can work in a tri lane.
I think Venge is pretty tricky to run here, I feel.
Yeah.
Because it's hard to close out the game against all that. Well, it's hard to close out the game, and it's hard to just live. You know?
Yeah.
Like you got a Slardar like running at you with Ion Shell. Ugh.
True.
That's like one of the worst feelings in the world as a core, is having to deal with that particular combination. But yeah, the Nyx is a pretty decent answer to Darkseer, at least in regards to lane, because we're not entirely sure. You know, Slardar could potentially be support. I actually am more inclined to believe it is support, given the three heroes that Virtus Pro have right now. They could also decide to put it in a safe lane, but that's like super rare. Don't see that too often.
Yeah.
And then in that case, you know, maybe we potentially see Faceless or VP decide they want to go aggressive, because a Nyx Darkseer 1v1 matchup, Nyx is actually all right in, because you can just mana burn the Darkseer, and then eventually, you know, before he gets a Soul Ring, you can kind of hold the lane a bit. You know, get your six, get your arcane boots, maybe try to make something happen off of that. Because
yeah.
They don't actually know what he's laning against yet on the Nyx. They just know that, you know, Lifestealer is banned and Jug is banned, which are probably two of the more dangerous heroes. So it does open them up for the possibility of an offline Nyx. But I'm also not sold that Faceless want to just do standard laning yet. Because I think if they do standard laning, it's going to be a rough game.
Virtus Pro, plenty of time to think about the fourth pick that they want here. But yeah, if you can get that Nyx versus Darkseer lane, you know, Nyx has that built-in regen that also helps him just deal with the Ion Shell, and he can get guaranteed stuns, kind of similar to the Nyx versus Bat Rider type thing. Just walk up to an Ion Shell with the Spike Carapace. But now Ember Spirit for Virtus Pro, so more big AoE magic damage to go with that AoE team fight combo we were talking about. I think it's a great pick here. Fits right in line with what they're going for.
Yeah, it's very Virtus Pro-esque. They always like to have a lot of team fight, and they always like to have a lot of pickoff potential. Between the Ember and the Slardar, you've pretty much already secured that. Fatal Bonds on top of Ember Spirit and Darkseer is just insane. Ember Spirit and Darkseer also have very good synergy, because we're talking about Ion Shell with Flame Guard.
Yeah.
The amount of like early game potential right now that Virtus Pro possess with their heroes, off the chain. Like just so high damage potential, and chase, and lockdown. Yeah. I'm looking at Faceless right now, and they pick, you know, Invoker's a really strong hero, absolutely, but he kind of needs time. You know, he's not going to be that insanely strong early game dominate my lane type of hero anymore. That's not how it works. You got to buy him some space. So I'm hoping, you know, seeing these heroes so far in Faceless, maybe give Black something that has a little bit more, you know, mid to early game focus.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Invoker, especially now with that, you know, the Midas change and stuff, he wants to play 4+1. He wants to split push, be solo in lanes, and just find pickoffs with Sunstrikes for a little bit of extra gold here and there until he gets really farmed. And that can be hard to do against the lawnmower, as they say. The Ember Spirit with Surge and Ion Shell on top of him. It is so much damage. And
Wait, actually, there is another choice.
Hmm.
They could pick Anti-Mage.
Oh, the Black Classic.
They could pick Anti-Mage, or they could pick Morphling again, actually. I mean, he's not like the super early game hero that we were talking about, but
yeah.
I think the argument for a more defensive core is that if it's Morph or if it's AM, it's actually pretty difficult during the mid-late game to actually deal with that hero on BP. They're pretty, I would say, mid-game focused at the moment with their current lineup. They have good Roshan secure with the Slardar. They got pretty good team fight, but a lot of their damage is magic. So it's a possibility. They could also go back for something a little bit more unconventional. They've done it in the past. But we'll see. I'm really curious, actually, to see how they're going to answer this.
Hmm. Are there any other options that come to mind for Black here? What about Naga Siren?
Does he play Naga?
I'm not sure, but I'm just thinking
think
about like
plays Naga when they pick it.
Oh yeah, I think you're right. Actually, I was thinking more just like in general, a Naga to break up the team fights. You know, if you can get the ults like after the rock comes down, for example, to break the combo in half, that is a way to deal with it. I don't know if it's the best way.
The only reason I suggest this stuff like AM or Morphling is because it's like guaranteed disengage. Your core just gets away. You know, he just blinks, he waveforms out, whatever. You know, you can dodge the fight. Okay, so it is the team fight oriented pick.
Okay.
So they're gonna go with the Void and the immediate Terror Blade.
No hesitation.
So
they wanted it. Okay.
I gotta level with you, Zayori. I really like Virtus Pro's draft. Like, I really like it.
I'm with you, man.
The problem that I think Faceless are going to run into this issue where they really lack damage unless everything is perfectly in sync. So we need like the Sunstrikes to be on point. I actually think maybe he doesn't have to scale Maledict, but I really think that Witch Doctor this game might need to think about going a little bit more damage oriented.
Oh yeah.
Just because, you know, Ember is hard to kill in you know, pretty much the whole game. Sardar, Darkseer, Terrorblade, all tanky heroes in their own right. Terrorblade pretty much is only susceptible to magical damage. If you're trying to kill him with right clicks, good freaking luck. And I do believe that if the game does go late, I think it's going to be too hard for Faceless to go late into Ember Terrorblade with their heroes.
Yeah, I agree. They have some cool combos, right? You've got Treant ult as well as Chronosphere that synergizes with Invoker Ultimate as well as Death, or not Invoker Ultimate, what am I talking about? Sunstrike as well as the Death Ward from Witch Doctor. So, you know, you've got some options. Nyx can do a little bit of damage outside of the Chrono as well. Void, there are some parallels between him and the Naga I was suggesting. You know, you can use the Chronosphere to break up the team fight, get that initiation, you know, stop the elusive Darkseer or Sardar from, you know, stunning or vacuuming you and then running away. So they definitely have options here. I don't know that it's a pure draft loss, but it's going to be hard, and they're going to have to execute this, like, perfectly. I think for VP, the ease of execution advantage is so much more straightforward, right? You know what all their heroes want to do, and they pretty much just need to get together as five and just land some of their spells, and this game will be pretty straightforward for them. You know, you can just kind of five-man around the Metamorphosis.
I guess it really depends on how well Black and Jabs play. Like, if the Chrono, you know, Meteor, Sunstrikes, or whatever are on point, yeah, you can blow some heroes up, no question. Again, it's just about, you know, how much time do you have? Are you going to be able to win the lanes like you want to win them? I guess in this scenario, too, you also have things like the Vendetta into Sunstrike with the Impale as well. It's a very high amount of burst damage. If for whatever reason Virtus Pro are spread around on the map, you can just get the free kill, which is good. But I'm still kind of leaning towards VP. Not like you said, not like a total blowout outdraft, but I feel like they have some advantages.
Yeah. And it's cool to see Terrorblade can be a very difficult hero to deal with. 11 starting armor. Kind of mind-blowing. Of course, he's
not
the most HP.
Yeah, you're just not going to... You're not going to right-click him, basically.
Yeah. That's one hero the Treant cannot pick on in these early levels. But I am excited to see the Treant and see how he fares, at least in the first couple minutes of the laning phase, see if he's able to put a lot of pressure on.
This is really smart, actually, from Faceless. So I was talking earlier about how I feel like a conventional laning phase would kind of put Faceless in a bad spot. They're just going to go aggro. They, like, immediately go for the rune.
And Lil maybe in some trouble here. There's the time walk forward from Black. A few more right clicks, and they might have this nice crush on two. And he'll make it back to the tower. That little heal from the Warlock, actually enough to sustain Lil through all that damage.
This is what Faceless want, though. Want this matchup to where, you know, they can force VP to move around the map, play as inefficient as possible, or make VP play as inefficient as possible just to kind of put themselves ahead. Because the more time they can buy for themselves, I think the better off they're going to be.
Mm-hmm.
But this is exactly what they're looking for. You know, Tree Witch Doctor is a terrifying support duo. Like, Slardar can't even go in. And Slardar is a hero that has, like, five base armor and whatnot. He's not weak at all.
So, VP down bottom. They'll have Ramzes on the Terrorblade, and Solo does rotate. I think pretty happy with this matchup. TB should be fine against Nyx Assassin to get all the farms Little Heart desires. So we'll see how the lanes continue to rotate. It's a 2-on-3 now up top. VP will just have the Darkseer Slardar hang around for now. They should put some aggression on the Nuts. No bounces on the Coconut. And this could potentially be a kill. They're on their way in, but the Ion Shell's doing a lot of damage here. Nuts able to cut his way through the trees, but it's not going to be enough to survive. Black able to time walk a lot of the damage. The double Ion Shell, Andy, just too much.
Slardar Darkseer, man. That is definitely a strong hero combination. No questions there.
Nasty.
He was really, really far out of position, though, to be fair. Like, yeah. He even took a weird path running away in the first place. Just maybe a bit of miscommunication. Maybe he thought that his lane mates were a little bit closer. But getting the first butt on the board like that, in such a fashion to kind of, like, dismantling the tri-lane as well. Not entirely sure if, you know, XY wants to really stick around right now. He's just trying to bully Noan out of getting this rune.
Yeah.
Is he just dead?
He might be. That's a leech seed.
Oh, what a rune.
Wow. I mean, I guess if it's a haste or an invisibility, he lives there. So there are a couple of options, but still. Fish your wish. But yeah, when you think about up top getting that kill, it's a 2-on-3, and the two were the ones that were able to pick up the kill. So that's a pretty big advantage for VP, given that Warlock was down bottom helping Terrorblade the whole time.
Yeah, it's definitely not something that should happen, but you know, periodically you make these little positional mistakes, and a really good team or set of players will definitely punish you for that. So, and now like Beck is up here on his own. Other supports have just decided to abandon the lane. That means that, you know, Pasha is going to get complete free farm. He'll be able to pull the lane as well and get the jungle creeps on top of that. This is a really, really good start for him. And Terrorblade, you know, sitting top of the CS charts at the moment.
Yeah. He's got Solo now to help sustain him up. XY is rotated, but so far they have not stopped Ramzes at all. Witch Doctor now in the mid lane, putting pressure on no one, making sure the Invoker has some space to farm. It's been a pretty even matchup there so far. Now back down towards bottom. Ice, Ice, Ice. Pops the Carapace. Stun from Lil. Actually gets returned. Nice stun on Sue. This could be okay for Faceless, perhaps. Solo channeling up a long upheaval, and it's actually going to turn the other way. Metamorphosis now laying in so much damage. The stickiness from the upheaval is more than enough as Solo continues to do damage with his team, and they set up a double kill for the Terrorblade. Very nicely done. Solo, knowing his limits, channeling that level 1 upheaval for so long. Not something you get to see that often in the first couple minutes of a match, but very effective in that situation.
Zayori, I've literally never seen a full channel upheaval in a pro game. Never seen it. It was something. You know, Ice,
never
Ice,
before
Ice
in the history of Dota 2, something, something.
Yeah, something like that. I think that Ice, Ice, Ice had the right idea. He wanted to stun Ramzes because he was meted, and he was scared about taking a lot of damage. But the problem is, upheaval lasts so long that it would have been more beneficial to just stun Solo. Speaking of, could be in trouble.
Here we go. Kind of a 3-on-1 here. Ramzes not able to help him. He's been hit by the Maledict, so he will tick down. Pop some stick charges, but Nuts takes credit for the kill. All right, well, a little bit of vengeance, but overall still pretty good for Ramzes, no doubt.
Yeah, the more interesting thing to me is, you know, this middle lane matchup, right now no one is actually, you know, leading by a couple of creeps. There hasn't really been too much outside influence on this middle lane from either team outside of, you know, XY just casually walking around trying to take the rune from the Ember Spirit. But once this Ember gets like 6 or 7, he's going to be moving around a ton, whereas Jabs is going to farm a bit more and might be going into the ground.
Yeah, Jabs in some trouble. Gets a tornado onto no one. That does stop some of the damage from coming out. But oh, wait, it's a Dark Seer. There's an Ion Shell on the Slardar. They'll be able to dive the tower and find another kill. Actually, Lil getting credit for that one. So always good to slow down that Invoker, especially before the Hand of Midas comes out. This is the time when you want to try to shut him down the most. Another good kill for Virtus.
Yeah.
Pro.
Unfortunately, the warding from Faceless didn't really help him that much there, because the Slardar was on the opposite side of the map of the ward, like he was bottom, so not being able to spot out the rotation in time, unfortunately, for Jabs.
Treant getting a ward down now. A little bit of vision here in the mid lane. How's Black doing in the off lane? Let's take a look at net worth, and he's actually number one. He's got 36 last hits. Turns out he's doing quite well, but speak of the devil, Lil comes in, time walk back. And just putting some pressure on. Void's really the only one that's farming well for Faceless right now.
Well, considering, you know, the lanes were actually supposed to be going favorably for Faceless, just given their, you know, early game rotations.
Yeah.
It's kind of a bummer, you know, because 2 out of 3 other lanes are pretty much losing at this point, and VP have decided to go ahead and just send Ramzes up top. Lil, behind enemy lines here, will be dropping.
Most
it's gonna make him work
likely.
More, though.
Yeah, absolutely. There we go. Void comes in, gets the last hit. It's got to feel good. And XY leeching some XP. Uh-oh, Pasha. Sunstrike just barely misses. Oh, wow. What a close call that was.
I'm not sure if it would have killed him, but it would have been close, for sure.
Yeah, but with Treant there, whomping him once, would have made things interesting. Nyx getting some space now in the bottom lane. Much needed space for Ice, Ice, Ice. You know, kind of the key to this hero is level 6 Vendetta, get off the map. Sort of like you were talking about with Spirit Breaker, you want to spend some time not visibly farming in lane so that there's that intimidation factor. You know, the Nyx could be behind me in Vendetta at any time. So, good for him to get some solo XP here.
Yeah, he's got his arcanes and like one creep too. Needs to be careful though. If there's a double shell on this hero, he's pretty much gonna die. Okay, XY is gonna scout it out. He should be okay.
Yeah. Lil looking for some kind of a wraparound play. All right, Hand of Midas, about 1,000 gold away for Jabs, 1,200, something like that. He's getting there, slow and steady, but this might slow him down even more. Lil rotates in, no one on the way. He still has the flame guard on,
cask.
Though. This cask is crippling, and they'll get the kill on Slardar. Now no one, getting low. Black is here. He drops the chrono just to be sure, and it ends up a double kill for Jabs. Huge turn for Faceless. Nuts, making it possible with that brilliant paralyzing cask right there.
I mean, I want to say that was unnecessary, but he did have stick charges, I guess. So there were, I guess there was a small chance that he could have popped stick and like remnant away. But yeah, better safe than sorry, I suppose, is the name of the game. And just like that, you know, Phases have pretty much completely recovered from the early game kill deficit. They're even going to get Pasha on the bottom lane as well. Jabs with the haste rune, just casually walking down there and right-clicking him to death. So
very nice.
Getting closer and closer to that Midas.
5-4, Faceless showing us a sign of life. And oh my. Witch Doctor dies here in the mid lane. Solo kill to no one. Looks like he just overstepped his bounds a little bit.
Unfortunately, that time there were no bonus things to bounce with Cask. So he just got ran at.
Oh, Courier up top. Ramsey's kind of sniffing it out here. He does have a meta. Needs to be a little careful. He does not have a point in Sunder. But Terrorblade's still farming pretty nicely. Oh, Black, maybe in a little bit of trouble.
This is
a
hard
time
kill.
Walk. Upheaval again? I don't think it'll be enough. He has time walk again in one. Beautifully timed stun by Lil, and they get it! Hard kill
God,
indeed.
He was like counting the seconds. That was a insanely well-timed stun. I want to say his time walk was actually being cast when he got hit by that.
I mean, Lil did some serious math right there. That was very impressive. Okay, well, a big kill. That really knocks Void down on the net worth chart. You can kind of see it. All of the core is pretty competitive, but now Invoker, the leading farmer for the Radiant, and he will pick up his Hand of Midas. So just shy of the 10-minute mark, actually ends up being a pretty decent Midas timing. He is 3-1-0, so took a tumble, but Jabs has kind of made up for it. That lucky haste rune rotation down bottom as well, giving him a little more momentum.
And once you get to this point as Invoker, you can kind of play off map as much as you like. You kind of just, you know, give lane to somebody else if you want, and you can just let Ice set up, you know, Sunstrike kills for you with his Vendetta.
Yep. Hey, Draskal, did you correctly predict number 3?
I don't even remember what number 3 was, but I don't think so. Nope, I didn't. It just showed up for me.
Pure damage, Darkseer, nailed it. Never doubted Pasha for a second. Yeah, Ember is a good choice, too.
Darkseer is the better choice, though, for sure, because, you know, double Iron Shell. It's happened so many times already this game. Plus, it doesn't really have, like, a timer. He can just do it right away, as Ember doesn't really, like, rotate that much until he's got at least one item.
Well, and Ember also has to deal with the Purge from the Tornado, and Invoker's kind of been locked in the matchup against him, so that's slowed down some of his damage output at least a little bit here. XY, Speak of the Devil, burning down, turns, drops the Bash. This could be a kill for the Ember Spirit, but just barely gets it. Sunstrike, no one sidesteps it. Very nice. Meanwhile, up top, another fight breaking out, and it looks like Dire come out big. Ice, Nuts, both go down. They do lose solo for it, but it's a 1-for-3 around the map. Of course, in favor of Virtus Pro. Caught the very tail end of the action up top. It looked like just a nice Darkseer back wall setup.
Yeah, that combination of heroes is just so hard to deal with, honestly. Because they both move so fast, right? Like, one of them has Sprint, the other one has Surge. It's like two pasted heroes, pretty much, with Ion Shells and a Disable.
Look how nasty this is, though. TB saved meta. He just popped it, so they can commit to this tower and a follow-up fight. Warlock ult comes down, connects on quite a few. There's the back in from Pasha, and this is going to be crippling. The follow-up's there from Slardar. Ramses drops the friendly Sunder to heal up Will. They'll finish off this tower, and they'll certainly make it too. Still half duration left on meta. A very convincing team fight for Virtus Pro. About a 1,200 net worth swing. But very nice.
Man, that Sunder was actually so clutch. I mean, I don't know if I would have Sundered there, because Lil was going to die to the next Maledict, because he had one more tick on him, and then he Sunders him back to full health, realizing that, you know, he's obviously going to drop if he doesn't. That was a very selfless play.
Yeah.
And, like, the fact that he's able to, like, pay that close of attention, like, during that team fight, I guess they won it pretty hard, so he didn't really have to commit that much focus. Because it was pretty much rock onto three heroes, vacuumed into the middle of an upheaval, and they're just massacred. This is a 0-2-4 Warlock. I cannot say I've seen this in a very long time.
Not even a single point in Fatal Bonds. Maxed upheaval. Wow. And it's working. That's the thing about it.
If you think about it, yeah, it's funny because you have all these frontline heroes like Darkseer, Slardar, Ember, TB. They're all heroes that pretty much stand between you and the enemy team. And Upheaval actually has a very long cast range. So,
Chrono? Yep, Black going in onto Ember. Sunstrike connects, cast bouncing around, and he will fall. So pretty big commitment, but still a nice pick onto no one.
Dude, look at this.
Upheaval onto four. Is there going to be some follow-up here, Black? Let's be able to time walk some of the damage. That does, look at that cast range. That is huge.
Yeah, it's massive. And the radius of it is also massive.
Yeah, so it extends even bigger than what this little arc shows you. That's crazy. The future, ladies and gentlemen, Upheaval Warlock.
Well, it's especially good this game because no one on the team of Faceless has an innate escape ability except for Black.
Yeah.
Like, no one has a blink, a leap, you know, even a force staff at this point. So getting out of that upheaval, and keep in mind, it also lingers. It's 3 seconds after leaving the AoE that the slow disappears. 3 seconds.
Yeah, that's the stickiness that I was talking about. That's what makes it insane. All right. I have some faith. It also just makes sense with the, you know, if you can combo that with a Darkseer, just vacuum, not even back wall, makes it so hard to get away. Here we go. Tier 1 tower mid and taking some pressure from Faceless. Black does not have the ultimate. It's a really long cooldown. Only level 1, so 140 seconds. Searing Chains on 2. Follow-up Golem. Boy just gets obliterated. Jabs on the run. Do they have the detection? Doesn't look like it, but they've got back wall. Oh, okay, never mind. They do. That's an easy 3. I mean, that wasn't even a team fight, Andy. That was just a massacre.
Yeah, they got obliterated. That was very, very tough for them. Ramzes, though, could be in trouble. Ice TPs with the Vendetta. Oh, but their Invoker's dead. They don't have Sunstrike. Yeah, they need that to kill.
Yeah.
I was going to say, if Jabs was alive or maybe even had buyback, it would have been worth it to just get the kill on Ramzes. But, you know, every single meta so far, or at least the last 3 of them, have pretty much resulted in teamfight wins and towers and then more towers. So, you know, in regards to efficiency, again, you know, VP are just playing some crisp Dota. They're getting a lot out of every single meta usage. Their golems have both accomplished a lot. Like, Solo ensured that Black died by chaining his Chaotic Offering stun between the Searing Chains so that he couldn't leap away.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they're just... They seem to be firing on all cylinders in the second game.
Yeah, absolutely. Manta style on the way for Ramzes. A lot of item progression coming here. Darkseer has the mech, Blink Dagger right around the corner. He's already been getting good vac walls. That'll be even easier. And Ember, he had the Veil of Discord in that last fight, but now Boots of Travel up as well. Double Midas on the side of Faceless. The Invoker. Pretty stock and standard. Ice. He did decide to go back for one, and I guess it is pretty standard on the Nyx Assassin too. And one of those heroes you spend a lot of time roaming about, so it just helps you keep tempo, find some farm while you're, you know, not sitting in lane.
Yeah, that's the one thing people forget about Nyx, is you spend so much time off the map that if you don't have a Midas and you're also not hitting creeps and your Vendettas are not successfully finding kills, you just become worthless.
Oh, no one jumps right into a Remnant. They were ready and waiting. They'll pick him off to start the fight. Now Black comes in. He drops the Chrono. Great Death Ward from Nuts. They find two, but now the turn. Back, and a meta from Ramzes makes it a 2-for-2. They do pick up only the 2 supports, and they lose one of their cores as well as a Tier 1 tower. But Virtus Pro showing that they can at least strike back. Even in kind of an ideal scenario for Faceless. I mean, they just destroyed the Ember Spirit before the fight started and really had a nice Chrono there in that little choke point.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's still more beneficial, I think, for Faceless. Unless VP managed to take this tower, then I think the trade would have ultimately favored Virtus Pro. Just because, sure, it was the expenditure of the Chrono, but killing two pretty important heroes, especially since, you know, the Sardar was so close to his blink at that point before he died, and then also getting the kill on the Ember. But yeah, this is still looking kind of tough.
Yep, XY now, Vac wall back, but EMP, Tornado combo from the Invoker. In comes no one, Searing Chains on two, they'll chop down the tree, and this poor Witch Doctor gets left behind. Cask will bounce around, but minimal impact as they clear out the creep wave. The tier 2 tower will fall, and with these two supports dead again, Virtus Pro have to be feeling confident.
There's just not much they can do without Chrono. They are so reliant on that spell.
Yeah.
If they don't have Chrono into like Invoker spells, like we were talking about, lack of damage. Where is your DPS actually coming from?
It's just such a brutal cooldown on Chrono now. It's like you need the Aghanims almost just for it to be a normal spell. 125 seconds. That's a pretty long time. You know, that's a Warlock ult right there. 165 on the Warlock ult, so just to put it in perspective.
Yeah, and I gotta say, the Warlock ulties for me have been doing a little bit more than the Chronos. I mean, it's not to say that the Chronos haven't been getting kills.
Yeah.
You know, solo drops a rock top, three heroes dead in a tower. Drops a rock mid, two heroes dead in a tower. That is like some serious value out of every single Chaotic offering. Yeah. It's not often that you see that, right? Like, sometimes you get like a pickoff or whatever, and it's like, okay, we got like chip damage on a tower. It's not guaranteed, boom, heroes tower every time.
All right, smoke rotation from Virtus Pro headed down bottom. Let's see what they can find. Jabs in the tree line looking to TP out. They will not be able to catch him. Good read here from Faceless. And they get out of dodge. Very nice.
I mean, it's very nice that they didn't end up getting a hero picked off, but at the end of the day, you can see their posturing. Like, they don't want anything to...
died, and now it's back. Another
mysterious
no lag in Dota, and this time OBS crashed. Well, either way, we're back, so sorry about that, folks. Luckily, there's no delay, given that these players are on land, so you missed almost nothing, and we didn't have to wait to see if it would reconnect. The only thing you missed was Roche going down here, and Dyer will pick it up. That'll be the Aegis in tow going to the Ember Spirit, actually. TB, definitely not one of the better Aegis carriers. You know, if you die, you lose meta even when you come back to life, so... makes sense. I guess Ember kind of the front liner anyway. Ember, Slardar.
Well, they've been committing Chronos to him too, so it does make sense. It kind of means that if you Chrono the Ember, you're just kind of guaranteeing that you're going to lose the fight in a way, unless the Chrono's hitting more than just the Ember, which doesn't really seem to have been the case except for the one inside of the jungle where they hit, I think it was Lil, and they hit no one at the same time. But yeah, other than that, it's definitely tricky. I mean, they're trying to buy time right now to get Jabs to his next item. He went for the Yule Scepter build. I like it, but at the same time, it's a very hard game to itemize as Invoker. You want Yules because when a hero blinks on your face and you get amped, you want to try to be able to dispel yourself, or you want to be able to dispel, the Ember. Oh, God. Goodbye,
well,
Black.
They caught Black, and... man, Ember with Veil and Ion Shell is... it's honestly a staggering amount of damage. You think of Void as a very survivable hero. Oh, don't worry, he can backtrack. But the duration of a Searing Chain, he dies. That's pretty devastating.
Yeah, between the two spells is 150 damage per second. Without, like, obviously amplification from the Veil of Discord or the spell amp from the Ember Spirit. And then Searing Chains is another 300 damage. So basically it's 250 damage per second while you're chained, not including Remnants.
Well, here we go. High Ground Siege. Terrorblade does still have... oh, he has meta coming up in 5. But they need to be a little careful here, because remember, Void is going to be coming up, and he does have Chrono. So there are some options for Faceless. No one's still holding on to the Aegis. Plenty of time on it. And with Terrorblade, you can just kind of keep doing this. Spam out illusions, slow siege from the low ground, very hard to deal with. Black jumps in on it. There is follow-up from the Invoker. They might be able to kill the Terrorblade. They've actually got the damage. Rock comes down on the other side. They bring down Jabs. Death Ward doing some decent damage. Ice, ice, ice. Scouted out. There's a Sentry Ward down. He's locked just on the edge of it. Remnant forward. That'll be the end of Ice, ice, ice. No buyback on the Invoker, but now Slardar jumps up to the high ground. Stun on two. And this could be the end. Two heroes down without buyback as Virtus Pro break the high ground. Slardar taking a lot of damage. Again, the coconut doing some work. So maybe not the end quite yet, but VP still take the fight. Golem will go down. Vac back. It's not over yet. Radiant still in a lot of trouble. Nuts slowly burns away as now Pasha gets credit for yet another kill. The beyond godlike streak continues as the tier 3 tower gets glyphed, but will soon fall. So at least open up shrines, most likely. Are they going to be able to save this tower? Draskal, they're going to do it. No one. Getting low. He will remnant back. Darkseer, he'll survive as well. Upheaval, slowing everyone down. Solo, the man of the hour, gets caught by the tornado. He'll get left behind. And this one straggler will be the prize here for Faceless, as they do indeed hold their tier 3. And with the Tyrion Protector, they'll be able to just heal it back up. That's pretty big.
It was such a committal, though. Like, keeping that tower alive. God, they dumped everything on that Terrorblade as well. I'm not entirely sure, but perhaps if the heal came out from the Warlock a tiny bit faster, the Terrorblade would have lived. Because when he popped Manta, he had like a sliver of HP, and I think one of the Meteor damage over time's actually killed him. All right, Ice.
Sunstrike connects on the Slardar and jabs, finds the kill. Another small sign of life for Faceless, but they are hanging on here, Draskal. They still have a big hill to climb. VP still very happily in control of this game, but Faceless showing a sign of life.
I mean, it was a stellar defense, for sure. No question about that. I actually can't believe they were able to take the Terrorblade down like that. I don't actually know if he got grieved or not by Pasha either. I'd have to watch the replay. I don't feel like he did, but then again, Meteor Sunstrike does a huge amount of damage, so perhaps he did and just died anyway. But either way, you know, it buys time, and that's what Faceless need. The Aghanim's is done on Jabs. He seems like he's holding on to his gold right now, potentially wants to just buy the bots or maybe just go for the Blink Dagger. Probably bots, I guess, at this phase, because he doesn't really have the inventory room to carry around a TP and an additional item, so... This is that kind of awkward stage in the game for an invoker where you have to buy bots even though another item might potentially give you more just for inventory slots. Like, that's kind of the issue that you run into on the hero, because you have to, you know, you buy Midas and that's just one dedicated inventory slot. You're always going to buy Ags.
Yeah.
It's a little bit tricky here. Mid again.
Yep, set up onto Slardar. Sunstrike connects, but not enough damage, and Ice will just look to survive. Lil jumps forward, actually returns the crush onto himself, will get grieved up, and Nyx Assassin in a world of hurt. He does have a friend nearby on the high ground. It's the Witch Doctor, and he is just going to leave him high and dry as he TPs home. Also, speaking of this Witch Doctor, he's made kind of an ambitious play in terms of item choices. He wants the Aghanim Scepter, but I do like it. If he manages to get it, it does help solve some of those DPS issues that we were talking about.
It's a Hail Mary, but it can be a huge payoff. Like, that's the trade that he's looking for right now. It's like, all right, I got Overgrowth, I got Chronosphere. There are pretty much no other two combination of abilities that are going to hold a team in place longer than those two skills. I guess Black Hole's probably up there too, but
yeah,
it could potentially be a huge payout. But again, like you mentioned, ambitious.
Well, here we go. Double damage on TB. He goes into meta form, and he'll get a couple of licks into this tower with the double damage rune, and they'll be able to bring it down pretty damn quick. There is no glyph for the Radiant, so they need to defend this tower and try to heal it back up if they can. He gets disarmed thanks to the Deafening Blast. VP happy to slow siege this, though, leaving everybody else on the low ground and letting Ramses do what he does best. Boyd jumps forward. Chronosphere, this is what they did last time. Sunstrike will come in, but this time they don't have the damage to bring him down. They mech him up. The Golem gets dropped. He gets off a Sunder onto XY, and now this fight looks like it could go the Dire's way. Vacuum together. No wall. There it is. It comes in a little bit late, but no one in the front lines doing huge damage. Three dead on the side of the Radiant. Only the Slardar down on the Dire. Make it four as Virtus Pro break this base wide open. It's a tier 3 tower down. Now barracks exposed. Only one hero with buyback. It's the Void, and without Chronosphere, there's not a hell of a lot he could do. Draskal, the hopes of Faceless in this series quickly dwindling. Backdoor protection, buying them a little bit of time here. They'll have creeps push in down in the bottom lane, so I think it's just going to buy them a couple of seconds for what will still be dead barracks.
Yeah, this is a rough one. I feel like this one was a bit of an outdraft, personally. I don't really think that there was much in the way of play that Faceless could have done better. You know, they get the really early pressure on the top lane. The lanes were going, like, reasonably well for them for a while. And it just, as soon as Virtus Pro start walking around the map with a Slardar. Like, Lil had so much impact during the early game. Oh, no one? Looks like it'll be okay.
Yeah, seems like it. I mean, if Black had Chrono, they have options there, but it's still down for a whole 45 seconds. Not even that close. Roche going to be coming up pretty soon here as Faceless. They actually go up to the high ground. It's a vacuum back right into the Slardar crush on three, and it's going to be another devastating team fight for Team Faceless. Invoker gets off a nice combo, does set up a kill onto the Ember Spirit. Nuts channels the ultimate for a decent duration, but gets stunned up by the Slardar, brought down as Ice 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 on his last leg. Does find a stun onto the Darkseer. Meanwhile, on the back line, Jabs still kind of playing with him here. Pasha does finish off Ice Ice Ice, but Jabs, the lone survivor, will not be in a position to save his crumbling base. They've already got two lanes of barracks down, top lane, all that's standing, and I think we could be almost moments from a GG here.
Yeah, that again, VP, super solid second game. I just think the sheer amount of aggression that VP put forward at Faceless, they just, with their heroes, they couldn't deal with it. He's going to go for a kill onto the Slardar. Jab is unfortunately not able to get it, and now he's dead.
Yep, the snowballs come in. Easy peasy. Ballsy Slardar.
It's one thing. I think one of the biggest issues that Faceless had with their draft is, you know, on paper, we talked about Nyx and how it matches up against the Darkseer, but that's really only given a 1v1 situation. And I guess when you pair it with an Invoker, you can see where the two heroes synergize and what you're actually meant to do. But the real issue is that your lanes just lose so badly that you just can't really ever recover from it.
Yeah, no doubt. Ramzes goes up to the high ground. They do have the Chrono, but Rock Vac back. It's going to be enough to keep him alive for the Chrono duration, but no, he gets popped straight away. Can't get off the Sunder. And Faceless might actually find an okay fight right here. They brought down the Terrorblade. But VP reinitiate instead of heading for the hills. They'll bring down Nuts. He buys back now. Ember Spirit biting off more than he can chew will fall as Jabs brings him down. And Virtus Pro get repelled. TP home from the Warlock as well as the Darkseer. The top tier 3 does stay standing. It does, however, cost them another buyback, but still a net worth gain for this team that is very far behind. Still about a 20,000 net worth deficit.
Yeah, it's looking a little rough at the moment. I'd say probably, outside of the fact that their lanes are really rough, they also have the complete dependence on Chronosphere. Without that skill, there's just, even the tree overgrowth has not really come into big effect. And when I say big effect, I mean I really haven't even noticed it in the game.
Yeah.
Because the heroes just don't care if they're rooted, because there's just so little damage coming out. They can blow up one hero, which is nice, but you kind of need that power spike of blowing up one hero before you're like, two lanes of racks down.
Yeah.
You need it to happen when you're like defending your high ground like they did top. I mean, sure, they committed some buybacks, but you know, they held.
Oh, Ice 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 initiates onto Solo. I might live to regret it here. Warlock, Sunstrike, not enough for the kill. And now Ice 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 left out to dry. Vacuumed back, slowed down by upheaval, and Lil will connect with the crush. 70 seconds, no Nyx Assassin. Pretty big window here for Virtus Pro to push out.
This is a fearless Slardar, by the way.
Well, Black will die. I don't think Lil has anything to be afraid of here.
All I gotta say is VP are looking super good at the moment.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure if that's a testament to them just being super good in general, or Faceless are just kind of having a bit of an off game.
Possibly a combination of both. I would say Faceless don't really look to be in incredible form here, but you know, it's not just... Maybe some of it's draft-related, but VP just always seem to be on the same page. You know, like, they have a very clear game plan of what they want to do. They hit these breakpoints, they move in as five, they knock down a tower, they immediately spread and go back to farming. You know, it's a very clear... I think you've used the word crisp a couple of times, but it's a pretty appropriate descriptor of how they've been moving about the map and, you know, maximizing on that individual farming efficiency as well as grouping up and still team fighting a lot around the Warlock ultimate. Of course, they finish off Roche here. Aegis of the Immortal goes the way of Ramzes. So this time they give it to the TB so he can just siege from the low ground. And if they catch him with the Chrono, well, he'll just come right back to life. So good stuff. Virtus Pro one step closer.
I guess Ice 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 is potentially looking for something, but he needs to play it pretty safe. They have a gem on the Slardar still. Yeah. This is going to be the make or break here for Faceless. If they lose this, the game is just over. Well, this particular fight, I should say.
Void has Manta Diffusal. Maybe the only real item progression we've seen out of the Radiant recently. This needs to be a chrono for the ages. I don't think they can afford just to catch the Terra Blade. He takes a lot of damage as he jumps forward, but Time Walk will bring it back on the backside of the fight. Ice, Ice, Ice initiated on, doing some return to Ember Spirit, but not able to survive. Definitely not the fight Faceless once here, as their Tier 3 is taking a lot of damage. Black caught by the chains. Now a crush from Lil. A bash, he mantas. Now the overgrowth from XY. Black makes it back up to the high ground, but BKB used by Ramses will finish off Nuts. And it looks like this tower will just fall. VP going for structures. Black still has the chrono, but unable to use it in any kind of meaningful manner. Kind of an anticlimactic ending here as Solo pounds the ground. Okay. Chrono, Sunstrike finds the kill there, but out comes the Golem, finally. And this is the final fight. Black locked down. Ember Spirit buys back to get right into it. No one could actually die back here, but no, he kills Black instead as he double remnants forward. Ramses with a little Sunder. We'll finish off the Witch Doctor and Draskull. By golly, I think we're going to have another 2-0 on our hands.
Yeah, this one was maybe not as decisive as the first series that we cast together, but I want to say that VP are looking pretty darn good. After watching these two games, like
there
the first one, they ran into some struggles. But this time around, it was like the Slardar moving around the map, the lane rotations from BP, everything just seemed to be on point. It was very succinct. They knew what they wanted to accomplish in the early game. They got their item timings up and just plowed, like just killed people over and over and over again. And there's just so little you can do. You know, we talked about mobility in the previous series and we were watching Mouse play against IG. Virtus Pro's lineup was insanely mobile. Three of their heroes can just travel the distance of the map in like seconds and they can just be there just murdering you. And it just created so much room for this like unorthodox but super effective like max upheaval build to do a lot of work. I've never seen that many upheavals last for that long in succession ever. Not even just in competitive Dota. I mean ever. Like, Solo was just sitting in the back, upheavaling, while there were just these three melee ion-shelled heroes just massacring Faceless.
It was sick. The perfect game for it. Absolutely. Pasha ending that game 17-1 and 23 on the Dark Zero. So I think that right there speaking to the impact of the ion shell, 22,000 damage, picking up a lot of those last hits. Very impressive stuff. So... all right, well, that brings us to a close. We had an early night here, Draskull. 2-2-0 series. I guess game one of this series was a little bit longer, but kind of a quick thread here. So there are still two more heats coming up today, though we are about to hand the stream over to, I think, Cottle Guy and Lacoste for the next two series, if I'm not mistaken. But I believe that schedule is located below your stream. Draskull, always a pleasure, buddy. Hopefully we'll be back tomorrow. Any closing words, thoughts of wisdom for the viewers before we shut it down?
I hope I get a 3-game series tomorrow. That's about my only request.
Woo! Can we get an amen on that? All right, buddy. Well, until next time, folks, thank you for joining us. I'm Ziori, he's Draskull, and hopefully we'll see you next time. We'll leave the stream running for another 10 minutes or so, and then hand her over.